Is there such a thing as state control over how media and democratic societies is reporting on and representing conflict? And if so, how does the control of media at times of war work? To answer these questions, we will predominantly focus on the United States. This should not distract from the fact that most other democratic states have put in place similar mechanisms of media control. But the United States merits a closer look, because in many ways it has been a trailblazer, whose initiatives have oftentimes been copied by other democracies. In the case of the United States, the war in Vietnam became the ground zero in the history of US media control. Vietnam fundamentally changed the way in which political and military decision makers viewed the media. And in its aftermath, new systems of media control were ushered in that, in one form or another, influence the nature of war reporting until today. But why was Vietnam such a turning point? This becomes clearer when we place the Vietnam War in the wider historical context. Prior to its involvement in Indochina, the US military had for a long time operated a system of media control. From the wars of colonial expansion to the Great War, from the Second World War to Korea, there was a tight system of censorship and control over war reporting. There was a clear sense amongst politicians and militaries that at times of war, the media had to support the nation's war efforts, that the media would have to refrain from reporting issues that could be seen as detrimental to American war objectives. But at the same time, from the perspective of the media, we could detect a similar sentiment. That at times of war, the media naturally tended to rally behind state leaders and behind the state's war efforts. Be this out of a sense of patriotism or a shared sense of threat, like fighting the expansionism of Nazi Germany and Imperial Japan, or the need to combat the perceived threat of communism. This alignment of shared perceptions between the military and democratic media can be traced from the 19th century all the way to the Indochina War. This meant that journalists covering US wars could float around battlegrounds relatively freely and with ease. US decision makers knew that, by and large, they did not need to control the media heavy-handedly. They could regularly rely on the media controlling itself, even to the point at which the media would engage in self-censorship. It was with this track record and the very same laissez-faire attitude that the US military entered the war in Vietnam. The difference being that in Vietnam, this laissez-faire attitude backfired. The Indochina War fundamentally changed the ways in which US militaries have looked at the media ever since. And it ushered in the perceived need to tightly control and manage the media at times of war. What triggered this change in perception during the Vietnam War was the Tet Offensive in January 1968. Named after the Vietnamese lunar year, the Tet Offensive was a massive military offensive across South Vietnam by the North Vietnamese Army and the Viet Cong that took the US by surprise. Hanoi's forces simultaneously attacked US military bases and key strategic locations in Saigon, including the US embassy. And in the ancient city of Hue, US soldiers found themselves engaged in the biggest firefight since World War II. Before Tet, US operations in Vietnam had been reported favorably by the press. The media had neither questioned the overarching objectives of the war, nor had it doubted the accuracy of the information given by US commanders on the ground. Following the Tet Offensive, US press reporting became more critical, increasingly questioning both the legitimacy of the war and the government's assessment of how the war was progressing. back here in the United States, the growing anti-war movement on the streets and in Congress eventually forced President Nixon to change strategy.
Vietnamization became the new watchword, and all efforts turned to finding an honorable exit from Vietnam.
The Tet Offensive was the moment when the United States lost the war politically. And this is quite paradoxical, because the military uprising by the North Vietnamese was in actual fact a military disaster for Hanoi. Not only was the Viet Cong wiped out completely, but also in addition, an estimated 40,000 North Vietnamese soldiers died compared to roughly around 1,000 to 2,000 American servicemen and women. In other words, US forces had successfully retaliated the Tet Offensive. But it was the images of Tet that sent shockwaves through the political system back at home here in the United States. While the Tet Offensive was a military victory of US forces in the jungles of Indochina, it was also the moment when the United States lost the war politically here on the home front. The war eventually ended in April 1975, with televised footage showing the communist takeover of South Vietnam, the fall of Saigon, and the hectic and hastened evacuation of the US embassy in Saigon via helicopters. It marked the first time that the US military had lost a war. Ever since, the prevailing view inside the Pentagon has been that the media has lost the war.
Well, because television was such a dominant medium during Vietnam, there was also the perception that because the effort in Vietnam went south after 1968, that television must be the culprit, that journalism must be the culprit in losing public support. This wasn't necessarily true, but it was conventional wisdom at the elite levels.
It became the media's truism that the Vietnam War could have been won had the media coverage not undermined the political support for the war here back at the home front. Now, whether this is a sober assessment of the Vietnam War is highly questionable.
Many people in the military felt that the press undermined the military's message that they were winning the war, and the press felt that the military was misleading the American public and so challenged their statements. And in fact, the press, by most accounts, was actually reflecting the American public's skepticism about this war as time went on.
Many scholars have spent at least the last couple of decades debunking the idea that the pictures that Americans were seeing every night on their TV screens were a daily infusion of blood, guts, death. Marines with Zippo lighters setting fire to peasant villages, the aftermath of atrocities. And in fact, as scholars like Daniel Hallin have long shown, much of the footage was actually far more tame and far more predictable, far less visceral than the image that we have come to think typifies Vietnam on television. That's not what the Pentagon remembers, however. And in the Pentagon's imagination, the nexus between TV coverage and a war that was lost seemed to be indissolvable.
In fact, the historical record clearly shows that it was not the media or the media coverage that lost the war in Vietnam. But in a way, it didn't matter, because the Pentagon and the White House came out of the Vietnam War believing that the media was the culprit, that it was the alleged media misrepresentation of the war that had lost them the war in Indochina. The media, in the eyes of the Pentagon, came to be seen as the enemy within.